One of the four basic routine investigations of pregnancy is VDRL. About 10 years back, I used to teach my students that of the four routine investigations of pregnancy, VDRL is the least important because we rarely get a positive case of VDRL. Well, recent evidence shows that I was wrong. I admit my mistake. Never take syphilis for granted. Ladies and gentlemen, syphilis is back. In USA, the prevalence of congenital syphilis has increased from 8.4 cases per 100,000 live births in 2012 to 15.7 cases in 2016, an alarming 87% increase. This is happening in Europe as well, as shown in this chart. A recent STD surveillance report shows a sharp increase in congenital syphilis among newborns in the US, with 918 cases reported in 2017. I am sure this is the case in modern India too. The only problem is we don't have any recorded reliable statistical data to show it. My name is Dr. Ajit Virkud. I am a professor of obstetrics and gynecology from Mumbai, India. My subspecialty is urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery. Obstetrics and gynecology is my profession, but teaching is my passion. My area of core competence is teaching basics of obstetrics and gynecology. Hello, citizens of the interweb. Today, I am going to talk to you about syphilis in pregnancy. I am going to take a deep dive into the basics of this sexually transmitted infection. I have divided it into two parts. In the first part, I will discuss syphilis in detail as a sexually transmitted infection. And in the second part, I will talk about the management of a serologically positive syphilis case in pregnancy and of the child born to such a woman. As usual, I will begin with the historical aspects of the disease, which are very interesting. Syphilis is a disease of nobles, kings, queens, and world-famous people, including a pope. Following royalty or celebrities were alleged to have been infected with syphilis. The examples are King Henry VIII and his wives, especially Jane Seymour, Ivan the Terrible, Queen Elizabeth I, Napoleon of France, Charles Darwin, Adolf Hitler, Abraham Lincoln, Leo Tolstoy, Casanova, Van Gogh, Pope Alexander VI, Vladimir Lenin, Christopher Columbus, Chairman Mao of China, Jawaharlal Nehru of India, Joseph Stalin, Edgar Allan Poe, Howard Hughes, Henry Miller, etc. Syphilis is caused by a gram-negative bacterium called Treponema pallidum. It is an obligate parasite, that is, it cannot survive outside the living human body. Syphilitic organism belongs to a group of bacteria called spirochetes, which are long, thin organisms having endoflagella, a band of protein that coils within the spirochetes, giving them the characteristic spiral shape. Endoflagella help the bacteria move around by spinning or twisting, like boring into a piece of wood. Transmission of syphilis can occur in two ways. First is called acquired disease. In this, syphilis bacteria enter the body through body fluids. This is possible when there are tiny breaks in the mucous membrane or skin of external genitalia or mouth during oral anal or vaginal sex, or by direct contact with an infected person's primary lesion. In other words, acquired transmission occurs by mucocutaneous route. Acquired transmission also occurs when people share contaminated needles. Vertical transmission from the mother to the baby mostly occurs by the transplacental route. It occurs in 60% of cases. Infection of the baby at the time of vaginal delivery is very rare. This results in what is called as congenital syphilis. The clinical application of this knowledge is that because vertical transmission is primarily transplacental and does not occur at the time of passage of the baby through the birth canal, the preferred route of delivery is vaginal. Acquired syphilis has three or maybe four stages. I will explain. First stage is called primary syphilis or the early localized stage. The second stage is called secondary syphilis or the disseminated stage. In 2/3 of untreated cases, the disease then enters the asymptomatic or dormant phase, which is called the latent stage. This is further divided into early phase, which is within 1 year of infection, and late phase after the first year of infection. They have no symptoms or signs, but the serological tests are positive. The remaining 1/3 of the untreated patients, however, will sadly proceed to the tertiary stage as a result of type 4 hypersensitivity immune reaction. I will now describe in details the classic lesions of primary and secondary stage of syphilis. 1 to 3 weeks after the spirochetes have entered the skin or mucous membrane, they multiply and destroy the skin and underlying soft tissue to produce ulcers, which are called syphilitic chancres, as shown in this picture on the left. They are painless ulcers. The diagram on the right shows the cut section of the ulcer, highlighting its characteristic diagnostic features. A syphilitic chancre has a hard base, raised or rolled edges, and is covered in the center with fluid rich in spirochetes, making them highly contagious. Although the ulcers are usually on the external genitalia, that is vulva or penis, because the infection is usually sexually transmitted, they can occur at other parts of the body, such as mouth, because of oral sex, or other areas if transmission was not sexual. These ulcers will heal spontaneously within few months. However, by this time, the organisms have already spread to the local lymph nodes, causing lymphadenopathy. Later, they enter the bloodstream, leading to spirochetemia that is responsible for the systemic stage of the disease called secondary syphilis. Remember, if the transmission is acquired through blood transfusion or via contaminated needles, there will be no primary chancre. The classic lesions seen in secondary syphilis are maculopapular rash and or condyloma lata. 6 to 12 weeks after the infection, a non-itchy maculopapular skin rash appears first on the body and then spreads to the limbs and eventually to the palms, soles, and over the external genitalia. Because they resemble copper coins, they are also called as money spots. Rashes resolve within few weeks to few months. Sometimes the patient can get smooth, white, painless lesions in moist areas and are called condyloma lata. These lesions are full of spirochetes, and therefore secondary syphilis is the most infectious stage of syphilis. Patients who progress to tertiary stage of syphilis have a type 4 hypersensitivity reaction, which is a type of immune response led by T cells which recruit phagocytes and cause release of pro-inflammatory cytokines such as tumor necrosis factor, interleukin-1 and interleukin-6. This leads to signs of inflammations such as edema, redness, warmth and fever. There is another thing that happens. The immune cells huddle around and are then surrounded by fibroblasts to form a granulomatous lesion called a gamma. Remember, the gamma does not contain spirochetes. The gamma leads to necrosis of the affected tissue. Various organs and systems of the body are affected in tertiary syphilis by these gammas. When the central nervous system is affected, it is called neurosyphilis. When heart and blood vessels are affected, it is called cardiovascular syphilis. Joints can be affected to produce orthopedic symptoms, and also liver and testes can be affected. Syphilis can also affect the eye, causing what is called as Argyle-Robertson pupils, where the light reflex is lost but accommodation reflex is present. It is because of its ability to affect and produce a variety of symptoms, syphilis is called the great imitator. In congenital syphilis, the spirochetes enter the baby via the transplacental route or very rarely via the birth canal during delivery. Congenital syphilis has two stages. In the early onset disease, symptoms and signs appear in the first 2 years. The baby can be dead in utero or be stillborn. If the affected baby is born alive, the baby will have non-immune high drops, anemia, maculopapular rash on palms and soles, and snuffles because the nasal passage is blocked by secretions that contain spirochetes. They may also have hepatosplenomegaly and optic neuritis. The baby may die in the neonatal period if not treated. Babies with late onset congenital syphilis are all right initially, but after they are 2 years old, classic lesions develop that have eponyms like saddle nose, Hutchinson's incisors, mulberry molars, saber tibia, and hearing loss. In many ways, like the tuberculosis organism, syphilis stands apart from other infectious diseases. Residual effect of a primary infection by an organism is either lifelong immunity, for example in toxoplasma infection, or lifelong latency, for example as seen with tuberculosis infection. But syphilis infection is unique in that it neither gives lifelong immunity nor does it offer lifelong latency. That is, if one gets the infection and it is not treated, it will stay there for a long time. But if it is treated, there is no permanent cure. One can get it again. Secondly, the organism cannot be cultured in artificial media. Syphilis is a great imitator, as I have already said, because it can affect various body systems and produce a wide variety of symptoms mimicking diseases of other systems like cardiovascular, central nervous system, bone, etc. This table shows the differences between primary and secondary syphilis. As I have already discussed most of the points shown here, I will not repeat it. I will just pause here for a few seconds for you to read the table. Before I talk about the serological tests for syphilis, I will talk about the syphilis antigens and antibodies. Treponema pallidum has three main antigens. These include group-specific antigen, which is present on all Treponema organisms. Species-specific antigen, which is specific to Treponema pallidum. And last but not the least, cardiolipin, which is a lipid antigen that is present within the spirochetes as well as on other cells in our body. Cardiolipin, a lipoidal material, is also released from the damaged host cell. After the infection, the host plasma cells produce different antibodies against these antigens. Antibodies appear 4 to 8 weeks after the infection. Because the organism cannot be cultured by artificial media, the diagnosis of syphilis depends upon the correlation of clinical data either with the demonstration of microorganisms in the lesion by dark field microscopy, which I will not discuss here, or by serological testing. Serological tests for syphilis include the following. Non-treponemal tests detect antibodies produced in response to a lipopoidal material released by the damaged host cell. These antibodies are traditionally referred to as reagents. For example, venereal disease research laboratory test, that is VDRL test, and the rapid plasma reagent, that is RPR test. Treponemal tests detect antibodies to Treponema pallidum. For example, fluorescent Treponema pallidum antibody absorption test, that is FTA-ABS, and microhemagglutination Treponema pallidum, that is MHA-TP test. Since it is practically important, I will discuss the VDRL test in detail. The venereal disease research laboratory test is a non-treponemal microflocculation semi-quantitative test which is used for screening of syphilis. It detects the IgM and IgG heterophile antibodies to a lipoidal material released from the damaged host cells as well as to lipoprotein-like material and possibly cardiolipin released from the treponemes. Only serum and CSF are appropriate specimens for VDRL testing. This test is most useful during the second stage of syphilis, when the presence of reagent peaks with typical titers greater than 1 in 32. It is less sensitive to primary syphilis, although there is a low level of less than 1 in 16 titer in about 80% cases of primary stage of syphilis. I will end the first part here. I will discuss the further details of VDRL tests, such as what is a significant VDRL titer and causes of false positive VDRL, etc., in the next part, where I will also discuss the management of syphilis in pregnancy and the neonatal management. Please watch the second part using the link given below. If you want to study more about this topic or any other topic in obstetrics and gynecology, please read the following books written by me: Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics, Modern Gynecology, Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, Questions and Answers, Clinical Cases in Gynecology, Questions and Answers, and Pelvic Reconstructive Surgery, a monogram on pelvic organ prolapse. For purchase inquiries, contact me at email given below or ping me at the WhatsApp number mentioned below. Also, please subscribe to my new YouTube channel called Modern OBGYN that deals with basics of obstetrics and gynecology, and press the bell icon to get regular notifications about new uploaded videos. Thank you.